that I found very interesting was grit, the idea of grit. You get pushed down and you stand up again. And there are some researchers that I read that basically said that grit is an important factor. But if you look at grit, I mean, how do you build is it a childhood thing? How do you build the ability to get up once you get pushed down? And why do you get up once you get pushed down? And why some people actually say that? How people get there?
In connecting, just a little bit, he says, it's actually just made the connections. It's apart from the VR stuff, I'm working on this documentary, and one of the questions, and this is for the first 3 years of life, and the Harvard Center for Developing Child has done a tremendous amount of research on what makes people successful. And I'm going to define what success is, once we can find it, but basically it's a little bit more career focused, and there's three factors that are constantly moving, and I think they're attributes that fit into a bunch of these things with other things. One is executive function, which is the ability to get rid of extraneous information and focus on what really matters. Delayed gratification, that you can wait to get the results that you want. Resilience, which is what we're talking about, and emotional regulation. Steve Jobs probably doesn't fit the emotional regulation. But it's interesting because there's actually a lot of studies around what are the attributes that really drive success for individuals. And those are three that just kind of summary to this one.
So, okay, so for example, those are the attributes.
Yeah.
The problem is then why some people have the issue that attitudes, why some people have those attributes in the numbers, and why some people don't.
I want to use more oxygen.
I think you said something very true, is that in my answer to your question, your proposal about said that they perceive success, and here's the definition of success, depending on each question, it's a different topic. So for some you have financial success, so you go after maximum amount of money you can get. Others can get success as recognition of others, say, hey, you did a great job, and it's the only thing that matters. I think I'm one of these persons, but I think people come and say, good job. And you can want to leave some piece of you in the history, so when you die, there will be still something here. And I think it's totally dependent on what you think is true, it's totally dependent on your definition of success. If you stay low, that means something you saw, in your opinion, means that you will not reach your definition of success. If you say, okay, I will leave something in the world, but I'm 18 years old, and in 20 years old, I don't think I can leave something, then I have to switch off and switch off success.
How much do you think actually that childhood influences to a very strong level wherever we are right now?
Well, what's right now? Because
right now, like today.
No, I mean, of course it very much affects your path, but you can reprogram yourself to change, like, you know. As people grow up, they gain more understanding of themselves, and you can actually, I think a lot of people that may think that they learn how to change their path of behavioral paths, or what they need to focus on to achieve their goals. And also, before you ask a question, I thought, well, there can be two different, completely different paths that can lead someone to greatness. For example, sometimes there are stories where people say, I had this amazing idea, go away, believe in it, never stop believing, and that's how I did it. And you have an amazing, successful, widely known brand. And then you have another story where someone's saying, you know, you have to learn, you know, listen to other people, and not stay within your own shell. Do you understand what I'm saying? And that's what leads you to success. In the end, I think it's very unique. It's a very unique path. I know you're saying that, like, for be things that always, but I really believe in, like, I don't know if this word applies here, but maybe singularity. Like, there's something special in your own path that for one person, if life approached him in one way, it would have been devastating. For another person, it would build him. Who knows? But you know yourself that, therefore, you can effectively plan your path, or plan your partner, or plan your approach, and have an effect on your success. Think of
that. I think if you love what you do, you find that being successful, regardless. I think it's very important that you love what you do. By loving what you do, I think it's great.
Absolutely. So caring, having a passion for it. Like ideas that rise from something that you really care about. It's very different than having a personal hobby. That not because necessarily you really connect to your being.
And once my mother gave me a recommendation, I was very stubborn, trying to do the thing for many years, and I wanted to be succeeding. And my mother told me a thing, and sometimes you don't even want to listen to my mother, because you think you know better. She said, Mark, don't try to go against the river. Follow where the river takes you. Follow where life takes you. If you're not succeeding in doing this, it's because it wasn't meant to be. And see what life is trying to tell you, and follow that path. And I did, and I was very successful. And I'm not doing what my passion was, but I can discover another thing that is my passion and I love to do. So
I had that change too, by the way. Could you
say a bit more? I don't know if it's too personal. Could you explain a bit more about your story?
I my dream was to produce television. I did 12 pilots. They were great. I just didn't know. I'm very creative. I didn't know how to sell them. So I wasn't able to sell any TV show. And my mother said, maybe you've been trying to sell TV shows for 10 years, this is not working, so maybe you have to change career. And life suddenly took me to another path. I wasn't so stubborn about selling TV shows. And I started doing another thing that life took me. So when I'm saying that where the river takes you, where life takes you sometimes.
You don't mean give up navigation. You mean give up going against the current.
Don't go against the current.
You can still kind of navigate.
Yeah. See where life takes you. Sometimes we have some power that we want to sell this product that cures this thing. So maybe no. Through that you're going to learn something and you end up doing another thing.
What did you end up doing? What did you end up doing?
Oh, now I'm building a house.
You're an architect.
I'm not an architect, but I'm designing homes and building homes. Nothing to do. And I got very sad because I went to my master's in advertising design to produce TV shows. And I'm not doing that. But thanks to what I learned, I'm capable of doing that, and I'm not an architect. But it seems what I do, people really love.
Don't you think changing the work frame you were trying to produce film or TV shows within an industry that was in a certain way? You were like producing pilots and nobody was buying things. Have you ever tried to produce a series of
I tried to produce many TV shows and my dream was to produce a TV show.
Yeah, but within a wireframe of an industry that works in a certain way, it's not right. And then TV network station would produce the rest. But then YouTube happened, and you could have produced the TV show with the same amount of money of the pilot, just take it directly to the people that you wanted to influence. And so maybe what was wrong was the wireframe, not the TV show producing, which is feeding within
the problem was that I wasn't capable of selling it.
But then that's what I mean. It's like, what if you didn't need to sell it? If you could just produce it in a different way, or crowdfunding, or and taking the audience. Maybe it was great.
Yeah, obviously, if I would have partnered with not the proper people, if I would have done different, probably I would have succeeded. But that being said, is that I would have never thought that I was being successful doing another thing. That was not
No, that's great, that's great. But what I'm saying is sometimes when you, so you said going, getting into the current, sometimes when you do change the wireframe, right? Because success is defined, really defining success by a certain wireframe, right? Sometimes you need to change the wireframe. Right?
Yeah, the other example. You, there are plenty of examples.
No, I just wanted to say that I think our society has set up a kind of a construct, a social construct. I kind of call it like the social train. So like we're all kind of put on this train as a child. We have to get good grades so that we can go to good universities, to get good grades so that we can get a good job, so that we can get, you know, a good salary, to buy the house, to buy the car, with a picket fence, to have 2.4 kids. Like, and we all go through that train and hardly question why we're on that train. And you were put on that train to study advertising. And
I never got on the train.
Some people never got on the train. I got on the train. I came from a very traditional Chinese family.
I missed it like at birth, you know. I saw that train going.
Lucky you, but a lot of us were put on that train and we don't question why we were put on that train. A lot of us don't. A lot of us don't. So, I mean, and my point is that, and I think you would agree, that, for example, the word Chinese, the word crisis in Chinese, it's idea, which is danger, and opportunity. So until there's a crisis, we don't question it. And in my case, I had a crisis in my life, and that changed my path. And that led me to, and I think in your case as well, no? And I'm just using that as an example. So maybe that was your point of crisis, and that was what led you to
bifurcate. I think in life, through problems, we grow. I think is what you're trying to say.
Yeah. So I studied architecture. I studied biology, wanted to be a doctor. Then I changed and got a master of architecture. Then I got my degree in architecture, and now I'm an entrepreneur. I'm not doing anything that I've studied. Nothing.
Me too. Oh, yeah. I'm doing all kinds of things that I study.
Then you study, but
I decided to write a book. You know, my crisis was I didn't want. Okay. At a certain point, I went and I studied. I went there to study cinematography, and they told me you're good at writing. You should write because the schools, they have an interest. They just want famous. They don't give a shit about you. They want you to be good so they can write that you studied there sometimes so they can bring in more people. So but I think learning is experimental. So I wasn't going to do that. I get scared. The minute they said you write well, I said, okay, I'm going to direct. Then they said, okay, direct. Then, so every time I jump, in the end I study animation and 3D and character design and I wrote a script and I got money for it and all that. And then at the time, I don't want to do any of the things that I'm supposed to. I mean, I just wanted to develop my way of thinking, and I did dream about all kinds of things. But in the end, I was supposed to meet someone to talk about, like, if I want to go to Pixar or something, like, what are the stages? But I didn't want to do any of that. I decided. And I didn't want to join a big company. I didn't want to work on small parts. So I just decided that I'll work in gardening in the day. And I did something. I decided, okay, I don't want to do any of those things. I wanted to be a creative director, but I didn't know the word yet. I didn't know that existed. I wanted to deal with concepts. So I thought, how can I showcase my abilities? And I decided to write a book. And they didn't tell anyone because they would say I'm crazy, like what my colleagues and my family. So I didn't tell anyone and I did it, and that got me my whole career started just because of that.
Just as a summary, there are three examples. There are things that. Thank you. So, for example, in these three examples, there were people that are talking about. Sort of like having a crisis and then having the power to decide I have control of my life, I change and I can actually change for the better. So this this is something that can be interesting. And I don't know how many of you think they're successful, but they have gone through that path in a way. And they think that taking that path has actually improved their life a lot. Okay.
Sure. I don't know what you do for this.
No, but that successful is a better person. More than successful.
Better person.
Better person. Okay. But let's say you have your brain.
Happy person.
Oh, better person.
I can add something actually. I like this idea that the crisis allows you to reevaluate what's going on in your life. Now, for me, I don't think it's not necessarily like we shouldn't examine my story for greatness. It's like I don't know what that is, but for my own personal greatness, it was a crisis was very important actually, and that was depression. So. I was working finance for 2.5 years. I was very much on that track.
You finance?
Yeah.
He still pens his nails.
Yeah, no, that came a lot later. Yeah. And I got just out of nowhere after about a year in. I got super depressed and anxious, and actually like suicidal. Like I had thoughts of jumping in front of trains in the subway. I mean, it was like really, really bad. But it led me to question everything, right? Question, what the fuck I'm doing? What did I go to school for? Who are all of these friends of mine that are playing into the same idea? Who are all the older people that I will become, and what are their lives like? And eventually, it led me to quit and start some of the things that I really wanted to actually do. And then the depression and all of the other things just kind of went away. So I do like this idea of crisis, giving crisis as a gift to reflect, right? To question the track that you're on. Because, yeah, like I went to business school, right? So it's very much, it's a school full of people on that track. So anyways, that's all I have to
do. Sometimes when you reach a goal, also you want to get back to being depressed, that can happen.
When you what, sorry?
When you, like, achieve what you were planning to achieve, you don't just turn out.
Okay, so for example, you raised your hand when you said about the crisis and coming up with a renewed, like, as a new person. But, I mean, in your example, for example, it takes a lot of strength, inner strength, right? You have two parts. One is, I go the one way or I go the other way. And generally see that certain people that then come out better, take the tougher decision, because it would be easier to take medicines and stay in depression, a lot easier. In your experience, what was...
See, I don't even think that's true though, man. I mean, for me, it wasn't like, oh, this will be easier. It was like, oh, I see where my life's going, and like, it's not going anywhere. Like, there was no... To me, there was no other options. Like, I had to. Yeah. So I actually disagree with the way that you...
No. Sure. I mean, I said it incorrectly. Yeah. But the idea is that you have two parts inside.
Yeah.
And during one is either coming out of where you were and finding all these things to do what you did after.
Sure.
I think it's hard. It's hard.
For me, it was literally like survival. Like, yeah. That's all it was. It wasn't, I don't think I did anything special, and genuinely, like, I don't really understand why other people who have the same crisis realization stay, because for me it was just black and white, yeah. I don't think I had particular courage or strength.
But you didn't jump in front of the train.
Yeah,
but I was thinking about it.
Well, it's great. Yeah, yeah. Then you decided to get out of that instead of jumping in front of the train. That's super great.
Yeah, but it's just, I don't know, man, it's like, it's not, it didn't, at the time, it just seemed like an obvious thing to do, yeah.
What do you got to lose?
How old were you?
I was 23.
Okay.
Yeah. What's that?
Not bad.
Yeah, well, I was going to say something different, but regarding what you're saying, I think wisdom has to do with how you learn about reading through body messages, and the body is many times wiser than actually what your brain tells you, and we all, when we've been like close to a crisis or really tough situations, you start not sleeping, your hair is falling, you are anxious and angry all the time. I mean, if you learn how to look at it from the outside and really read the messages, it's like obvious you have to take a position, just from in a selfish way, right? From a selfish point of view. I was going to mention, there's a very good book, I don't know if you know it, a small one called How You Measure Success by Clayton Christensen. That has to do a lot about what we're discussing here, but you know Clayton Christensen, the disruptive innovation guru, right? And also he went through a health crisis, and it was about, you know, he was sick and tired of seeing all these successful guys that went, like, seeing through business school in Harvard, etc., and they all ended like being corrupt, or some of them in prison, some of them had a heart attack, the other one divorced because he was never home. So in the end, it took him to write all this reflection. It's like, is this success, or what is really success? It's about impact, it's about being good with yourself, right? So it's a very good small book that I recommend.
I think what's really important, it's not only what the decisions that we take, but the decisions that we make based on who surrounds us. And when you think about it, like, who are you voting? Are you voting, or is your political opinion based on what you really believe, or is it because what you believe, or what the people around you believe? So I think there's really a chain of who surrounds you that defines who you are, what you think, and what you do. And you have been surrounded by finance, and that was your train, and that was the normal. And in order to leave this, you not only had to change yourself, but you had to change everything that surrounded you. And I think this is really important to be aware of that you can change who you are by being around you.
On that note, I mean, I have one rule in my life. I have many rules in my life, but that's one rule in my life, which is exactly that. I only try my best to surround myself with people who makes me a better person, and who supports me. And then you return that support, and you return that trust, and you return that, because if you surround yourself with toxic people, like in the, you know, I'm not saying all bankers, or I'm not going to generalize, but like if they were toxic to you, then you need to remove yourself from that situation, or whatever situation, like the hospital is making you sick, then you leave the hospital. Like, find that environment where you can grow best, and it's different for everyone.
What's interesting, going to the story that you told about 4 or 5 years ago, a big venture that I put, you know, everything into, went slowly belly up, and I went through this period that now looking back at it, it was a depression. It's kind of funny how you might not recognize the depression when you're in it.
Yeah.
It just kind of really sucks.
But when you're out of it, you look back.
Yeah, oh my God, that was pretty dark. And I read a bunch of stuff, looked at a bunch of stuff. I spent a lot of time, you know, trying to find what is my passion, what really drives me. And I couldn't get anywhere. I kept on and had this metaphor of, you know, finding my little purple frog in the Amazon that I need to save, and I came up with nothing. Like, I could not find something that I was like, this is really what drives me. And then I read this one article that sort of shifted everything around, because tied to the question of success and tied to some of this stuff is, what do you want to do? And that is a really difficult question to answer. Some people have it really clear, some people don't. But the insight for me was, don't think about what you want to do. Think about how you want to feel. And then imagine yourself when you're 80 years old, how do you want to feel about your life? And when you start to look at the emotions that for you would make that life fulfilling, and that could be power, that could be whatever you want, but when you focus on how do you want to feel, it then becomes really interesting as a lens to look at, I don't want to feel surrounded by toxic people. I want to be inspired. I want to be energetic. I want to be... And suddenly that starts to open a pathway of thinking to help define your own definition of success, which then allows you to map it into what is greatness for yourself. And if you look at it from the emotional perspective of how you feel, it suddenly becomes a much deeper, much more profound, and also way more actionable. Because you control it.
Is this that we're discussing something that can be taught to people, to talk to children, or is there a personal journey? Because it's, I mean, most of you have gone through a personal journey, and then which has been a crisis, coming back.
You need to have a personal journey, but I think you can be equipped with certain tools to know how to make the best out of that journey and learn the most out of that. I mean, I don't think you can teach people how to be successful from scratch, but you can equip them with tools and resources and things that help them manage that journey. navigate that river. Understand, because you're in touch with your emotions, to realize, wait a second, I am hitting myself against a wall constantly. And it's not that I'm not being persistent enough, it's that I'm banging against the wrong wall. Kind of shit.
I like it. It's like
you can definitely teach it.
There is a wall that is appropriate to bang.
So then with that question, is success an evolutionary response? Is it a fight or flight mechanism? You know, is it like, is it a question of dopamine in the brain, something that makes you want to keep going? Like if you were cave people and you're trying to hunt down an animal and you fall, do you get up again because you have more motivational hormones to get there? Or is it something that has to do with the environment or adaptation to the environment? And then also, does it have to do with, once again, if you're going to die or not? And if you look at success in different countries, depending on if you have a safety net or not, success in different countries is very different. For instance, if you have the States or Spain or Sweden, where I lived for a long time, Sweden is extremely comfortable. If you fail, you're not going to fall too far. So people don't tend to be as entrepreneurial as in the States, for instance, where you can really only go one way. If you fall, you're probably going to crash and burn. And I think that's a huge factor to success as well. Whereas in Spain, for instance, if you fail, you really don't have to try it because beer still costs a euro and a half. And you can still buy that with, you don't need to succeed, whereas in other countries, you're almost forced to succeed if you don't want to burn. So once again, like the US, I feel, is like really engaging your fight or flight mechanism, this evolutionary response to not die.
I don't know if I, back to what you said, I don't know if success should be defined by social. I don't know if it's a country dependent or cultural dependent thing. I think if you define success for your own terms, it's irrelevant.
Yeah, but everybody's very different, and you know, what is it being right and wrong about? Because one person's success is listening, I thought the way I
a content.
But for another person, it's like, listen.
Yeah, sorry. So you
I think we should talk a little bit about what it is to be great. Everybody can have that success. Anybody can talk about how they can get a nice equilibrium. But going back to what you were saying in the beginning about these factors like grit and all these things, I think, sorry, greatness, I think it's breaking boundaries and being a leader in something. And I think that greatness and success both also come from happiness. Sorry, they come from desire and unhappiness. And desire is basically the anti-Buddhist thing of not needing it. You have to want something. You have to want to change something. You have this thing that you want, whether it's to get better, and then happiness could be simply you don't like the status quo. Like Elon Musk doesn't like the status quo of energy. Or you don't like the status quo in what you're doing in a career, and you're unhappy and you're gonna keep working at it. So I think that desire and happiness.
So success for a Buddhist is enlightenment, you know? That's success. And success for someone else is like something like money, and success for an artist is being remembered forever. Who knows? Like everybody's so.
But I think that's
right. That's why I started greatness.
But success is very.
But the thing is, what we're actually talking about is very, let's say, academic in a way, because success is so different from different people. So I actually just want to add two things. There's one study, I'm not really sure what was set up, that was in Harvard. It was a long study, I think it was 75 years long.
Robert Walters.
I think there's even a TED talk.
No, yeah, interviewed.
And they interviewed different kinds of people from, you know, low key, like, you know, really low, you know, low education to president of the United States. So that's actually it. What came out of that study of, you know, 75 years is what's the key of success and happiness. That's relationships. So that's the only thing. So actually, yeah, we have a family, we have friends you can relate to, you know, be toxic people, not really people that really, you know, trust you. And then that's one thing. And the other thing is, I was at Burning Man last year and met the founder of Burning Man, Larry. And he said to me, we had an interesting talk, and then he said to me, he knows so many unlucky billionaires, you wouldn't believe it. So that was really something which is burned in my head, meaning striving for money. For having, you know, even growing the bigger
unhappy.
Unhappy. So there will be,
desperate people which are really not lucky with the status quo. So they are all that just cannot enjoy life. So that's something which, of course, is not a status, at least I don't want to, you know, achieve. Not to be lucky and happy. So I think money is one dimension, but the other dimension could be if you do something good, you know. So if you help in a refugee camp for having a year or do something which gives you a good
also, job, you know? I think we're also programmed for community.
Exactly. Yeah.
I think sometimes we don't realize it, you know. I participated in the Connecticut Book Club, so I had to read a book. I didn't want to read it.
Me too, the same thing.
I enjoyed it very much. Yeah. And I was like, I at the beginning it was like, I'm supposed to learn in the summer for school and I'm not doing my homework. In the end, I really enjoyed it and I realized that it's a big part of my life that I hadn't noticed that is super important to me. And I always try to achieve it everywhere I go. I think community is a big part of a lot of our happiness, being appreciated.
Yeah, I think you change around the world. What you want to talk about, people are the same. What you want to talk about, if you marry, for you to be successful, so have a happy marriage. If you have children, your success is to see your children happy. When they grow up and they leave your home, and if you grow up, your success is to have a balanced life. So I think through your life, you have always to figure out, this is like a path, it's not an end by itself. So what you find is to be successful in marketing, it's not the same, and you will keep, it's like, it's really a path, it's why you are always trying to figure out what you want to do with your life. I think it's not a one answer on the whole life, it's changing depending in which phase of life you are.
There's something related to what you said on your things. There's a difference, and I think this is a very cultural thing, your point. It depends on how you define success. It's defined by something that's out of you or something that's inside you. So, and that makes it whole different. It's you know, Buddhism, for example, is all about you know, finding your thing, not defined by anybody else. It's not cultural, it's your thing, it can be anything. Success. But I feel that to be happy and successful, it needs to be defined by you. You need to change the wireframe to the setting and set it up in a way that will make you happy. Because if it's external, you might be happy and fulfill it, but you might not.
But therefore, your happiness is something that you achieve forever. You have to be constantly building your happiness.
No, of course. But what it means is defined by something external. If you say, I'm going to be successful when I marry, that's something external.
No, because your marriage is like a job for your whole life. It's not, you are not happy just because of marriage. You are happy if you are able to keep your marriage for 50 years.
Spanish guy.
I thought to myself, I'm going to last at least 2 minutes. That's like my measure of success. Like, if I can manage 2 minutes, I'm happy with myself. I actually managed 2 rounds of 2 minutes, so it was like 4 minutes. And I always got lost, like I got beaten up so badly. I couldn't eat for 3 weeks. I'd only taken straws from here. My nose was all over the place, my head. But I was happy. My mom was talking to me on the phone. She obviously cried her eyes out. But all I could think about, fuck, I could take that guy's punches for 2 rounds of 4 minutes. Like, that was a huge thing for me. So I trained in the same club for 12 months again, and I met him 12 months later on the ring. This time I managed 3 rounds. I still got beaten up, but I got less injuries. So, and I learned Spanish. So that for me was a measure.
So I think we need to break
can
up.
Can I just say one last thing?
You can ask one question.
Just really quick, okay. Really quick. Okay, so I think I discover how I can arrive to greatness, and I wanted to see what you guys think.
Okay.
Is
that
to,
is not going to be quick.
No, super quick. I think that I will be really happy and I'll be really great if I give no fucks. I give no fucks of what my parents think of me, zero fucks given. I give no fucks if my clients like me, I give no fucks if my employer or my children or whatever. Like, no. Give no fucks.
Because you have to do the
things. I always want to try to get out.
Because if you do things for to have other people, if you do things to have other people happy, you're never going to be happy.
Yeah. Exactly.
You have to do things to be happy yourself. And that's the key.
Yeah, but caring
that
makes
you
happy and that's giving a fuck. I love giving a fuck.
I don't really think it makes you happy if you are happy. I mean, I don't know if you are.
So.
But you said when you were, he's not happy about yourself.
Okay.
You said when you were being your mother, your, I don't know, he's not happy with you because since you have that pleasure, you cannot be happy.
Yes,
maybe a father did
it. Are you?
Is this father?
Is
this father?